ESPN coverage is streaming live on the ESPN app. Download now and take ESPN everywhere.
Welcome back to Provo, Utah. One of the most interesting aspects of this rivalry is how many coaches have similar backgrounds. The head coaches, Kyle Whittingham and Kalani Sitake, both have histories with the opposing schools. Paul Carcaterra has more.
Well, Mike, the coaching crossovers in this game run really deep. For Utah's Kyle Whittingham, he's had a family member involved in this game for 44 years. His dad coached at BYU, and he played for and coached under the legendary Lavelle Edwards. On the other side, Kalani Sitake was a fullback at BYU, and coaching under Whittingham at Utah, he adopted many of his defensive philosophies. And Kalani told me yesterday, Whittingham, along with Lavelle Edwards and Gary Anderson, those are his coaching mentors.
Paul, thank you very much. BYU has won the toss and deferred to the second half.
This first drive will be interesting, Paul. Got a new quarterback. First time he's ever played in the Holy War. This will be fun.
The rivalry renewed here in Provo. Fans are ready and the teams are ready. Corey Edwards set to kick it off. Kyle Fultz is deep. Edwards, four kickoffs this year, two touchbacks to his credit. Returnable kick. Fultz lost it. And a great start for BYU. Utah is led by Tyler Huntley, a sophomore out of Hallandale High School in Broward County, just north of Miami. He came to Utah with a couple of his high school teammates, Zach Moss and Damari Simpkins. Last week, in his first start at the college level, Huntley threw for nearly 300 yards and a touchdown, and he ran for two more scores. He unseated Troy Williams, who was the starter a year ago, and went 9-4. The running back is Troy McCormick. They fake it to him, and Huntley keeps. Breaks a tackle across the 20, 30, and knocked out of bounds.
That's what we talked about. BYU has to tackle. They can't give this kid yak yards, yards after contact. You see here, first contact, don't leave your feet. This kid's going to be a good runner. He's going to get better and better as the game goes on. They can't let him get past the line of scrimmage.
Matt Hadley, their number two tackler, he wears number two, missed the tackle, would have held him to a short game. Two running backs. Again, it's Huntley. That option look has given them two outstanding runs. Fred Warner, who had 18 tackles the first two games, was in on that one.
Well, it's just a quarterback attack. They ride the running back, Troy McCormick. He reads the end. He either hands it off or runs it. They're going to force the quarterback, Huntley, to run the ball early, obviously. They're going to have to change their tune on that.
He wouldn't mind being forced at this rate. Huntley will keep it again. Moss, good block. Huntley, another nice run. Now a flag comes in as Huntley was drilled at the 43. The only thing wrong with this, coach, you keep running your quarterback, you may need another quarterback.
Well, they're going to run him to death, but what they've got to do is now they've got to take the quarterback away and they force give the ball
holding
off the running back.
Offense, number 9, 10-yard penalty. Replay, second down.
That's Darren Carrington, their outstanding wide receiver. That takes away another big play.
see Carrington Hole right there on number one. You know, young kid, straight out of Oregon. 9-10 catches last week, but he's got a block also.
Huntley bobbles it. Somehow keeps his composure, completes to Harrison.
His knee was down.
Tight end.
Yeah.
Now they will say the play is over.
Yeah, his knee was down when he picked it up.
Two mistakes in a row.
Yeah, pretty low snap.
Right knee is down.
BYU's got to get their composure on defense. Again, take away their number one player now. Take away the quarterback. Force them to hand the ball off horizontal. Don't let them go straight downhill.
Big third and seven here. Another bad snap. Picks this one up, swings it out, has it blocked at the line of scrimmage. So after being gashed three plays in a row, BYU gets a break on a couple of bad snaps and a penalty. Kyrus Tonga was the man who got his hand up. He didn't have to get it up too far. He's 6'4 and 340. Just came back from a mission this spring. They expect incredible things out of this kid. And here is your Ray Guy Award winner from a year ago, Mitch Wisnowski. Just an unbelievable kicker. Led the nation in kicks inside the 10. Second in kicks inside the 20s. Punted twice this year. Both are 52 yards. Tanner Mangum will be at the helm for the Cougars. The junior out of Idaho turned 24 just yesterday. He co-MVP'd the 2011 Elite 11 quarterback camp with Jameis Winston, who is starting his third NFL season. That's because right out of high school, Mangum went to Northern Chile for a 22-month mission. BYU desperate to get a running game going. It was shut down a week ago by LSU. And they'll try the jet sweep look out of the backfield as Trinneman and Jonah Trinneman able to turn the corner.
That's what they were lacking last week, misdirection.
Tanner Mangum 2 years ago set a freshman record but lost his job when Taysom Hill was healthy last year. This year he's off to a slow start. 54.9% completions in this day and age is way too low. Guy goes in motion. And they'll turn and throw it to him. Bobbled the ball and dropped it at the 18. Let's check in with Chris Cotter.
All right, Mike Thomas checking on what's happening over on ABC. Inside the shoe, Baker Mayfield's having himself a heck of a game, especially in the second half. Here finding Trey Sermon for the score 10 yards out. Bob Stoops loves it. Why not? 24-13, Boomer Sooner, early fourth.
Third down and five here from the 14. Thank you, Chris. Big early season game there. Can Lincoln Riley get a huge win this early in his head coaching career? Four-man rush, no pressure. The pass underneath, knocked away, and it looked like it was intercepted, picked off by the nickelback, Booby Hobbs. Let's see how the officials rule it.
Good break on the ball here by Hobbs.
The ruling on the field is a catch of the pass, but it's fourth down.
It looked very close to being a pick.
Right. Tie goes to the runner. Good catch. That's not a very good opening series for BYU on offense. So strength versus strength. BYU's offense versus Utah's defense.
Linehan will punt to Hobbs. Makes the fair catch at the 45. 38-yard kick, no return. Back after this. If you're a student out here and you want to be first in line, you have to camp out starting the night before because they don't let anyone in until a little bit after 6 o'clock Mountain Time. And then most people sprint for the seats they want.
So not only do you have to be dedicated, you want to be first, you have to be in good shape.
Looks like a lot of fun.
Not for me, it wouldn't be. Moss is the running back along with Huntley. Huntley keeps again and throws over the middle. Complete. Caught by Darren Carrington, the young man who transferred from Utah after several off-the-field incidents and has been a star here.
Yeah, this is what happens when you get the run going. Play action, draw the safety up, number nine, easy throw over the middle. They're going to see that all night, but they've got to stop the run. Continue to focus on the run.
Full house backfield. Huntley with a read, and McCormick lost his footing and went down. So the only thing so far that has stopped Utah is Utah.
All right. Impact players for Darren Carrington, Zach Moss for Utah. Two offensive players, obviously, and BYU defense, Fred Warner and Sione Takataka.
You just passed your first challenge. Second and a long three. Moss. A good job of shaking off that first tackle and diving forward. They'll mark him at the 38-yard line. Takataka made another tackle. Young man out of Fontana, California, who already has two sacks. Third and 11 now. BYU crowd really into it. Don't see much red in the stands, do you?
With four offensive returners, they look a little bit jittery.
Damari Simpkins checks in. Four wide receivers. Huntley wants to set up a screen and does. McCormick will be knocked down at the 34-yard line. Well shy of a first down, and there is a marker down as well.
Looks like we have a hold. Hard to do that with a screen pass when you're supposed to let them through. I never understood that. They had 11 penalties last
holding
week.
Holding offense number 70. 10-yard penalty. Replay third down.
So if they had declined a penalty, it would have been fourth and about
right.
Four. I guess they don't want to try that
right.
One.
Right. But they had 11 penalties last week. Kyle Whittingham said they cannot do that again. They've already had two tonight. And both of them look like they could be drive breakers.
So now third and a mile. But Huntley has already proven himself to be very dangerous. Three-man rush. Throws underneath. Ball's loose. And Utah somehow got it back. That came out of the hands of Raylan Singleton. Fred Warner really drilled him. But Utah manages to get on it.
Fred Warner has been all over the field tonight, but they're going to the open end most of the time. But that was a great hit right here. Got to protect the football. Got to, last year, they had a dozen turnovers combined with both teams. They can't turn the ball over in rival games like this.
No, sir. Wisnowski with Jacobson deep and put it at the half-yard line and gets the bounce backward. What a kicker this kid is. And now they're going to say that it is a touchback. We'll look at it again.
ESPN College Football is presented by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. And in part by the strikingly designed Lexus NX Turbo and Hybrid. Some things are simply impossible to ignore.
That's the BYU Museum of Paleontology that houses fossils from this region of the United States, Utah and surrounding states. We thought this punt, at first blush, was just short of the goal line, but the replay will show it just nicked the stripe, and it was a good call by the officials. All it has to do is touch it.
Give them credit when credit's due.
Yes, sir. And the ball comes out to the 20. Straight up the middle for a couple of yards, and that's it. Kavika Fonua is averaging 6.5 yards of carry with 10 carries. Again, they struggled on offense a week ago. You got to give LSU a lot of credit, of course. But if you rush for minus 5 yards, you have very little chance to win a ball game.
Yeah, they're in a quandary because the best players on defense are the D-line. First starters on first-year starters in the secondary, there's three of them. So what do? They've got to create some run, but they also have to throw the football.
Second call at 8. Fake to Fonua. Mangum with pressure, throws underneath, and it's intercepted. Hobbs. Booby Hobbs. Threw it right to him. To Ty Detmer, the old coordinator.
He's looking the post route all the way down the field, and he stares it down. Number one, Booby Hobbs is a nickelback. He just dropped underneath the post route and made the easy interception.
If you have talent in the secondary, you cannot stare down a receiver. They'll do this to you a lot.
Especially in a pro-style offense where all your receivers are kind of bunched in. You know, if you've got wide receivers out wide, and you can do it a little bit more.
They go to the shotgun. Zach Moss, number 2, is the running back. Blitz coming. Moss. Ooh, drilled. Fred Warner can really play. I mean, he sticks people.
Yeah, he's a captain. He led tackles last year in the 2016 season, but he's going to have to continue to make those. They're running right at him almost every play.
Just get the feeling here, Tommy. BYU cannot afford to make mistakes and compete with Utah.
No. Looked like more talent in terms of skill players this first half, first quarter.
Quarterback draw. Huntley tripped as he dives. It was a good play by Tausinga. They've got some big defensive linemen. Everybody's around 300 pounds.
Tyler Huntley, they're going to do everything with him. And that's the reason they changed coordinators. They went to a new coordinator, one-year college coordinator. Came from high school 2 years ago. But this is the spread offense, the quarterback attack, and all of it centered around your quarterback.
Got a tight end in there. Split out a couple of yards. Two wide receivers. The toss to Moss. Moss spins off the tackle, knocked out of bounds at the 3.
Too many missed tackles. They got to wrap up. Moss is a good running back. He's not that fast, but he's strong. He's the type that you got to take out low.
I was wondering if they might go for it here. They've had so much success on offense, but they send the field goal team on.
This is huge for BYU to hold them to 3 points.
Who was a walk-on who only played 1 year of football. And after Chayden Johnson missed the opening field goal try of the year, they called on him. He has not missed since. And he still hasn't. 4 for 4 on field goals, and his range is close to 60 yards. They may have really found something. That's the turnover that set it up. The Utes on top, 3-0. Last year in Salt Lake City, after a touchdown with only 18 seconds to go, pulled BYU within a point. Kalani Sitake decided to go for the win, but his quarterback, Taysom Hill, was brought down well before the goal line, and Utah was a winner again. Coy Detmer, the offensive coordinator, one of the great quarterbacks in the history of college football, knows he's running uphill in this one.
This will be a big series.
This one will go out of the end zone, and they will take it from there. Tomorrow afternoon, the U.S. Open's men's final between Rafael Nadal, a 15-time major winner, and the 6'8" South African Kevin Anderson. You can catch it at 4 o'clock on ESPN, streaming live on the ESPN app. Nadal 4 short of the great Roger Federer. Fonua is the single setback. And Mangum, who is only 1 out of 3 with a pick, will try to get something started. That ball is tipped. Caught anyway. Great concentration by Talon Shumway, who has outstanding hands. And he gains 20.
Play action, you see how the offensive lineman cut the defensive lineman, but the defensive lineman still got to tip the ball. Excellent catch. They're going to have to make a lot of catches like that tonight. But you saw the pass protection that time. They do not want penetration. They're going to cut him at the line of scrimmage.
Tell you, Mangum was staring him down, too. That's one of the reasons that was blocked at the line of scrimmage. Straight up the middle goes Squally Canada. Let's take a look at your impact players, Coach.
Impact players for Utah is Chase Hansen, Kylie Fitz, obviously defensive players that have to make a lot of tackles in the secondary, and then Matt Bushman and Tijan Kuroma, the center. These two guys have to create a running game for BYU tonight.
Spot the ball at the 48, second and 6. Off the right side, some space for Fonua.
Good job of Fonua breaking the ball outside. This play was meant to go inside, inside power play. They spilled it to the outside, the defensive line. He made a good cut to the outside.
And these folks desperate for something to roar about. They get a first down in Utah territory at the 45. Two tight ends, two wideouts, and Fonua the tailback. Fonua straight up the middle, cut down. The leading tackler, Tao Tioli, got the first hit.
You know, this linebacker crew for Utah is ranked the top linebacker group in the Pac-12. And they're going to need to be that tonight because they're going to have to make a lot of tackles inside. That's a great job by that kid there. Coming in and actually almost made a loss.
Shumway goes in motion. Blitz coming, and Mangum was crushed. The safety, Hansen, they say that's a loose ball instead of a pass. No whistles yet. Loa Fatatanga got the recovery, and Hansen just unloaded on Mangum.
The ruling on the field is now under replay review.
Hansen coming from the outside. They never picked him up. Never saw him. 44 had to block him. It's going to be close.
So close, isn't
it? So close. If they didn't have instant replay, it'd probably be an incomplete pass. But they're going to get a good look at this. But he had no chance here. The back had to block the outside. Busted protection. They can't have that happen. That's what BYU lives on. They live off protection, protecting the quarterback, getting the ball down the field.
I mean, the way you look at this is his arm coming forward. Yes, it started to, but it didn't come forward very much. So I don't know how an official makes this decision, except they ruled on the field that it was a fumble.
Yeah, they'll have a tough time here, but if I was picking this, I'd pick an incomplete pass. It looked like his arm is going forward. Chase Hansen's their best defensive back, and that was a good safety blitz. But again, they've got to be able to pick that up. He had to come from 12 yards deep to the line of scrimmage, and you've got to be able to see that.
The language is it must be indisputable evidence to overturn it. That's just by the definition of that word, it's not.
Yeah. Well, I've seen many of them that weren't indisputable.
Haven't we all?
We've all seen that. So it just depends on your replay booth. Looking at it in slow motion, his arm is going forward there, but he's also hit at the same time, and the ball goes forward. That's something that they've got to look at. Most of the time, the referee is going to let that play out and not blow the whistle just in case, you know, it was a fumble.
Jim Fogeltanz is the replay official. He's kind enough to come in and say hello before the game. I don't envy him this choice.
No, this is pretty tough. But it's a situation here where, you know, you've got to use common sense. You know, you've got to protect the quarterback, number one. His arm was coming forward, but was it coming forward enough?
Boy, and Hansen was just flying when he hit him. Either way he decides this, he's probably right.
After review, the ruling on the field is that it was an incomplete pass. The quarterback's hand was going forward. It'll be third down. The game clock, please reset the game clock to 4:02. 4:02.
Of course, each side sees this with their heart, not their eyes.
Yeah, really. Again, Chase Hansen on the line of scrimmage. That's a good. The ball's going forward. He got hit about the same time.
I agree.
Again, it's like both defensive backs catching and receivers catching at the same time. Ty goes to the runner. Big turnaround for BYU. They couldn't afford to give that ball again back to Utah in great field position.
Tanner Mangum's lucky he's still got a right elbow.
Yeah. Well, now they're spreading it out. And when you spread it out, you can't get those type of blitzes, but they look like they're going to go down 8-man drop, rush 3.
Mangum forced out of the pocket, has to throw on the run, and it was intercepted but out of bounds.
You've got to throw that ball away.
Yeah, he threw it late, didn't get a lot of spin on it, and Jalen Johnson was right there to pick it, and he was being hit when he threw it.
Illegal shift, offense, that penalty is declined, fourth down.
Caleb Rupp was putting the pressure on.
BYU showed a little life on their offense. Again, they made almost more offense on that drive than they made all last week. They can't throw the ball up for grabs. That ball should have been thrown way out of bounds by Mangum. Utah's in safe punt. Just make them punt the ball.
Hobbs is deep. They come with a rush, but don't get there. Hobbs will let it go. That may have touched a Utah player.
We'll get a replay out of that.
Casey Hughes. Boy, that was so close to hitting him.
First of all, he should have never been that close.
Well, there was no touch of the ball. First down, Utah.
This BYU crowd is going nuts. And Utah can breathe a sigh of relief. Hughes is getting a good talking to on the sideline from his head coach. Did it touch him?
Actually, he got pushed into the ball, but it doesn't make any difference.
No,
you
doesn't
still
matter.
Can't touch it. You can't be around it.
That angle, you couldn't tell. Maybe we can see it here.
There's nobody to wave him off. The returner wave him off yet.
Holy cow.
Oh, it's close. Number 5's got to wave everybody off.
Now, that's the kind of break BYU needs to get back in this game.
That's what they get for growing the grass so tall. We talked about that earlier. The ball doesn't bounce very far.
No, it doesn't.
If it had bounced, it would have been a fumble.
Boy, and Hughes just breathing a sigh of relief. That's a tough play. If you're back blocking one of the gunners, how are you going to find the ball?
Exactly right. Now Utah has difficult field position. Now we're going to see them operate with 90 yards of grass, and if they continue to make the mistakes that they're making, they're going to give the ball over to BYU in good field position.
They keep looking at this, possibly searching for any other angle, but
after review, the ruling on the field stands. There was no touch of the kick. It'll be first down for Utah.
And as you might guess, the local faithful did not like the call.
You got the call on the fumble in the pass, but they didn't get the home field advantage.
McCormick is the running back. Huntley gives it to him. Gets the corner and out of bounds at the 10. Let's go to the studio and Chris Cotter. Chris.
All right, Mike, Tommy, let's update you on what's happening inside the shoe. Oklahoma strikes again. Jordan Smallwood, I promise you, in real time, was a lot faster than this. There you go. Takes the end around to the score. Now, Ohio State just kicked the field goal. It's 31-16, two-score game on ABC.
All right, thank you, Chris. Utah's moved it out to the 11. Empty backfield for Huntley. Flanker screen. It's going to be a double pass. There's a flag down, and Carrington couldn't find anybody. Now the flag down late. That's a gutsy call from that deep in your own territory.
Now look at this play. It's a trick play.
It may have been a forward pass to Carrington.
We have a stack formation on the outside.
There are two fouls on the play. Both fouls are against the offense. An eligible receiver downfield, number 69. That penalty is declined. Holding offense, number 80. That penalty will be enforced half the distance to the goal, second down.
This is Carrington right here. They're going to throw a lateral pass. You can't throw two passes forward, so that's a lateral pass. They've got too many people down the field, obviously, but nobody went out. Somebody busted the play. Probably number 80 was supposed to go down the field. There was no double pass to be thrown.
Second and 11. That's Ciosi Wilson called for the flag. Over the middle, McCormick fights his way up to about the 13-yard line. That'll bring up a third down.
Last week, Mike, they threw a lot of screen passes in their first game. We haven't seen one tonight. So I'm talking about outside screen. We'll see what kind of pressure we get from BYU. It looks like they're going to play zone.
So four-man front. Another low snap. Huntley throws. McCormick makes the catch. It just messes up the timing. That's three bad snaps in the first quarter.
Hard to play quarterback when you're trying to play infield.
Yes, it is.
Looks like they're going to measure. This is a big call right here for BYU. They need good field position.
Falu Maka is the center. That's three he's put on the ground.
I'm not so sure that Huntley knew the ball was coming. It looked like he was still looking at the defense.
And that's even worse than just getting a low snap.
Yeah.
A surprise low snap, and they are just short. The yellow line is not official, but it's close. And boy.
Yeah, the ball's in his right arm. Red Horner is all over the field. Punters in. It's hard to run short yardage when you never take a snap underneath the center. And I've always thought that you had to have some plays underneath the center just for this situation. You can't snap it 5 yards back and try to get 6 inches.
That's a great call. Here were the rankings for Wisnowski last year when he won the Ray Guy Award. He's a consensus preseason All-American here. First or second in four different and the most important kicking categories. This time it's a rugby-style kick that will be down near the 30. A 53-yard kick and no return. In 2009, the Holy War went into overtime. Down by three, Cougar quarterback Max Hall hit Andrew George for the game winner. It was a 25-yard touchdown play. It's the last time BYU has beaten the Utes.
And after being here for 3 days, Mike, these fans think it's been 25 years.
Of course.
6 years is a long time.
You know, people in other parts of the country might say, well, so what, a rivalry between Utah and BYU. To these people, this is bigger than Texas, Oklahoma, and Auburn, Alabama. They could care less about those. This is their rival.
That's what makes college football special.
Throws behind his receiver, but Shumway made the catch. This kid has a 38-inch vertical jump. Here's some of the rivalry games that you were in. Which was your favorite of all of these?
Well, probably Southern Arkansas Mule Riders versus the University of Arkansas Monticello Boll Weevils.
Only because of the nicknames.
And that's when I played. Didn't play a lot, but I was in the game.
Auburn, Alabama must have been a boot.
Oh, yeah. Catholics versus convicts. They were all fun.
Second and about a yard for Nua, moving the pile forward, and it's a first down for BYU. In a fast-moving first quarter, only 1:23 to go.
That was good movement by the offensive line. Again, they had none of that last week against LSU. They've got to create that running game, and it's easier to run the ball inside against a four-man front than it is outside. And that's the reason you're seeing more inside runs. Both teams run four-man fronts. Both teams are trying to run the ball inside.
That is their second first down rushing tonight. They had none against LSU, as you can tell. Bonua again nailed after a gain of about three. Fotu, one of the tackles that they rotate in and out, made the stop. And that loss, minus 5 yards rushing and less than 100 total. They didn't get across midfield.
Todd Dittmer, the offensive coordinator for BYU, took a lot of credit and blame for that because he felt like he held the quarterback back. He said he's going to turn him loose tonight. We'll see. Looks like he's doing a little bit better.
They want him to be not so mechanical in his progressions, more instinctive in the way he says. Nine the back throws underneath. There's an example because sometimes he wants to go 1, 2, 3 in that progression tree. He doesn't give 1 or 2 a chance to develop.
Yeah, and we talked earlier in our players of the game, Matt Bushman, the tight end, he just got off a mission. He's a freshman, but he's a huge player. He's got great hands.
If you hadn't watched the scoreboard the entire game, you'd think it might be 17-0. But at the end of one, it's 3-0. Welcome back to ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by GEICO. We're in Provo, Utah, for the renewal of the Holy War, Utah and BYU. The Utes came in as slight favorites. They played like it so far. But BYU trying to get something started here.
Good field position. Need to make some first downs. Put them back to back. They need to get more consistency.
Mangum has been a little sharper on the last three throws. Guy goes in motion. They whistle a play dead. Looked like Schoaf, the left tackle, got started early.
False start. Offense, number 71. 5-yard penalty, third down.
Austin Hoyt gets the flag instead. He is a first-year starter on this line.
Utah's starting to play a lot more man coverage now, and that's the reason they're going to these bunch formations on BYU side and motions to try to get the tight end open. They got him open the last time. Let's see what happens here.
They said they would play some more zone coverage. They love to play man. Mangum with time, throws complete. That's going to be a first down. Caught by Aleva Hifo. Plays the slot and plays outside. Chase Hansen made the stop.
He makes a good break on this ball. You know, again, young secondary. They got to go deeper. They got to go intermediate routes to deep. They can't go short. That involves the linebackers. You got to take on these first-year corners and first-year safeties.
And Hansen is the only returning starter in that group. Well, Bakri checks in as a blocking back in the middle of the eye. Fake the run. Here goes Mangum. Slides. Had his helmet taken off, and there's the flag. Tautioli made the dive. Made it late. You just can't hit the guy who slides. Sometimes you're in the air when he slides, and it's a tough, tough call.
New rule 2 years ago, if you slide, you cannot not hit the quarterback above the shoulders.
After the play, personal foul with targeting, defense number 10. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
That's a leading tackle.
This play is now under replay review.
Now take a look at it upstairs.
Yeah, that's targeting.
I think it's a good call.
Excellent call. He's got the crown of the helmet. He's not playing with his eyes. Obviously knocked the helmet off of Mangum.
Oh, and he ducked his head at the last minute, too, to just put some emphasis on it.
Well, there's no reason for that type of play, and that's the reason we've got to take this out of football. We've got to take helmet to helmet out of football.
After review, the ruling of the field of targeting is confirmed. Number 10 is disqualified from the game. BYU player number 12 may remain in the game.
Tautioli is their leading tackler, and he's gone.
And he is all over the field. They're going to really hurt.
Was.
But they've. Here you see he slides, and you've got to protect the quarterback, and you can't lead with your head as a tackler. There's really no reason to even go down. He knew he was going to slide. Just go over the top of him. Just a poor decision.
We know now what happens to people who get hit in the head, and they've got to stop it as much as they can.
Exactly right.
Mangum, short set, quick out. Shumway down to the 16-yard line. Let's go to Clark.
Well, Mike, with Tautioli now gone and ejected from the game, next man up, Donovan Thompson, an undersized linebacker at 5'10", but this kid has a keen eye for the ball, flies all over the field, and is able to make some big-time stops for the Utes.
And, Clark, I know people want tall this, tall that, tall this, but if you can play, a guy like Sam Mills didn't have a problem for about 18 years, did he?
London Fletcher, right?
Yeah.
Another one. It's the heart, Mike.
Absolutely. Bouncing off a tackle is Fonua. They moved him from linebacker this spring, and all of a sudden, he has turned into the featured running back.
And
nobody has produced a whole lot in that position.
And where do they run? Right where the middle linebacker is supposed to be.
Sure.
They're going to try the new guy out. But again, they're deep at linebacker, ranked number one group in the Pac-12. So we'll see how he plays. But as you said, small linebackers are usually the best because you can't block them. I've had several of those in my coaching career.
Trey Dye is the running back. And I've heard people say of short linebackers,
timeout, BYU,
when they're leading tacklers, well, he's too short. So what? The timeout on the field, back after this.
Chris Cotter in studio, Notre Dame trailing Georgia, trying him out. A drive in the final 2 minutes, but Ricardo Wimbush is sacked. Davin Bellamy forces a fumble. Bulldogs recover. And they're going to hold on for the victory right now. It has gone final. Georgia with a big road win at ND.
How about that, Chris? BYU, a team that has been dominated, trying to tie it up or take the lead.
New back in the backfield.
That's Dye. They look his way, throw over the middle. That's a complete pass to the tight end, Matt Bushman. Very athletic tight end. And they say they really need more explosion out of that position. 40 yards on the first three drives, 61 on this one alone.
That play, they put Trey Dye in motion. They pull the linebacker out. He's supposed to have man coverage on the tight end. Easy throw, easy catch. Again, that's what they'll do against man coverage. A lot of motion. Try to get people confused.
First and goal. Fornua is back in as the deep man in the eye. Four-man line for Utah. Fornua got maybe a yard before he was pushed back by the center of that defense. And Kylie Fitz.
Fanua's got to do a better job of cutting off his blockers. Seems like every time he just runs right up their back. He's either got to go inside or outside. There's not always going to be a hole where it's supposed to be. That's from playing linebacker last spring, I guess. Moving to running back.
Mangum has hit five straight on this drive. Faced with a passing situation most likely here. Second and goal. Bunches the receivers to the right side. Swings it out, Fornua in the flat. Dives to the three. Third and goal.
Well, it's going to be interesting right here. They got the big back in the game. I would spread it out and continue to throw the ball. Third down, you've got to try for the touchdown. You run the ball. They haven't averaged 3 yards a carry all night.
This will be the 12th play of this drive. Third and goal. Utah shows blitz. They come. Mangum pumps. Touchdown. Shumway.
They got a pick play right here. Number 15. They're going to get him for a pick.
And you had to wonder how he was that wide open, don't you?
Pass interference. Offense, number 15. 15-yard penalty. Replay, third down.
Good catch, Tommy. Hefo, the man called for picking a defensive back.
Here's the inside receiver. Watch what happens. He works to the outside. Man coverage. You can't do that. You can't shield a defender. Easy catch, easy throw. Penalty.
You really have to pretend it's an accident. You certainly can't block him. But he did. So now BYU has to do it all over again, but they're back at the 18-yard line.
Put him in tougher field goal position.
Four-man rush this time. Mangum. That's a nice shoe-top catch by Fornua.
They just zoned it up. They were going to make him throw the ball underneath.
Now you have to go for the field goal, you would think.
Oh, yeah. That's just a tough play down there. But the inside receiver, you run that over and over in practice in the red zone every week when you're working on those plays. You always tell you cannot shield on purpose. Now, you can clip him as you go by, but if you stop and shield, they'll always call it.
28-yard field goal for Rhett Allman. And it is no good. Holy cow, what a disappointing end to that drive. They get a touchdown call back after a penalty, and then they miss a chip shot field goal. Just outside the post.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by Ram Trucks, America's longest lasting pickups.
They call it Hike the Y. It's an easy, albeit steep, trail that runs up to the block Y on the mountain. It's a very popular hike for college students, and they light it at night. You get a great view of Utah Lake and Provo. Now, the missed field goal. Watch the holder. He gets the ball. He loses it, but he gets it back down. Kicker never hesitated. Allman probably should have made that anyway. Deep post and caught at the 32-yard line. Wilson made the grab, and what a throw by Huntley, who was leveled as he let it go.
Play action. Hang it up, throw it to the goalpost, which means throw it to the middle of the field. The receiver will make it there. Ended up pretty good. The D-back, yeah, 32 didn't play it very well. He should have broke in front of it. Good pressure.
Well, that's off his back foot. He had no leverage on it at all. Get back to the ground, pick up about six.
This looks like their first drive of the game. They're going back to putting a quarterback involved. Run the ball inside. Make the quarterback run out with the backs on the fake. And then run play action off of it.
Huntley only played in four games last year when Troy Williams was the starter. He was basically mop-up or emergency duty. But he looks like he's in command of this offense now. Throws a bullet out to the sideline to Raylan Singleton, who makes the catch. The ESPN app is a man's best friend. Stream every ESPN college football game live at home or on the go. Get access to scores, news, highlights all season long. Download the ESPN app to start streaming now.
All new D-line in the game for BYU. A lot of substitution.
Huntley hands it off, and they'll pick up a couple. Zach Moss gets the carry.
They got a lot of push in the offensive line. That's pretty much a lead draw right there, where they have a lead blocker in front of the back while he's moving in motion. But the quarterback can also can pull it out of there. Kind of freezes the linebackers.
Hadley made the tackle. Second and six. Huntley after the fake. Boy, good ball fake to get another 3 or 4 yards out of it.
Same play they ran the play before. That time he just pulled it out. Naked bootleg. We've seen that a million times as we was growing up, Mike. That's a play of the past.
Still works though, doesn't it?
Yep. Fred Warner took the fake. This kid's got a little bit of speed.
Got to be tough for him and Moss and Simpkins to play tonight and concentrate fully because of the hurricane. Huntley straight up the middle, gets down to about the two.
Again, quarterback attack. Back goes horizontal. Make the fake. Read the end. End goes out with the back. Quarterback pulls it and runs up the middle.
Those three kids that I mentioned, all from Hallandale High School in Southern Florida.
They flew over a lot of schools to get here, Mike.
Yes, they did. Some 2,500 miles. Second and goal. Can BYU stand tall? Huntley throws on the run, touchdown. Well-designed play, and it's Troy Williams. No, excuse me. Carrington, the young man from Oregon, who was the Ducks' leading receiver before he transferred.
Pass interference, offense number 80. 15-yard penalty. Replay, second down.
C.O.C. Wilson called for interference. Did we have another pick play?
Let's see here.
Yes, we did.
He went after him. But see what happens on that. Number five should come off anyway and cover him. There's a combo coverage. So the pick play really didn't make any difference. Number five played it wrong.
It was Gawoloku who double-teamed the one receiver deep, leaving the other receiver wide open in the corner. Huntley couldn't find anybody and throws up in the flat to Moss. Moss breaks a tackle, gets down to the seven.
Huntley's getting way too much time, but he's getting time because of all the play action. They slowed the defensive front down. They slowed the linebackers down. Now they kind of got him off balance.
Tommy, Utah's just faster and more athletic, it seems.
Yeah, they got more athletes on this side of the ball. But it starts at the quarterback. You know, you have to defend 11 players when you have a quarterback that can run.
McCormick is in, third and goal. He moved up in the slot. Huntley looks that way. Now he's forced to run. Throws back of the end zone. Tipped in the air and incomplete. Looked like two Cougars may have had a shot at it. That would have been a huge break for them.
You know, that was a great throw across his body.
Yes, it was. Had some,
and it looked like it
had some mustard on
it. Across his body. Carrington was there, but great play by the defensive back. I didn't catch his number, but
Tanner Jacobson.
Yeah, you can tell how athletic this kid is. He probably shouldn't have thrown the ball. He probably should have ran it. But again, he likes to take chances. We've seen that the whole game.
Jacobson is in there playing for Micah Hanneman, the young man who can't play in the first half because he's out for targeting. It's 6-0 on the field goal. Legendary BYU head coach Lavelle Edwards' last game on the sidelines was the Holy War in 2000. It was a wild fourth quarter after the youth scored 17 points for the lead. The Cougars followed suit for the game winner, and they sent Lavelle Edwards off for the Holy War win on Utah's field. And we are in Lavelle Edwards Stadium. Nobody has more respect in this area of the country than Lavelle Edwards, and they wear a patch with his profile on him.
He was a prince of a fellow. I've known him for a long time and played golf with him. And I give him credit for starting the forward pass in college football because he originated it right here.
What a great kickoff man Wisnowski is. He's also the All-American punter. A lot of guys on Utah's staff played for BYU, including Kyle Whittingham. There's a lot of back and forth with these two programs. Whittingham, amazingly, is the third longest tenured coach in the country. 13 years. This business has changed, Tommy.
He's been involved in this game 44 years.
They'll start from the 25. Jet sweep. They give it to Bo Tanner, his first kill. They're trying to find anything in the running game that works. Here's Paul Carcaterra.
Well, Mike, pressure, pressure, pressure. That was a theme on the side of Utah from a defensive standpoint. And Kyle Whittingham's a defensive-minded coach. The man system, you need linemen to get to the quarterback. Last year, Hunter Dimmick had 14.5 sacks. That was tops in the Pac-12. This year, it's Kyle Fitz. He's got to set the edge. He was not around in 2016. He had that Liz Frank injury.
Out of the eye. Blitz coming, and Tanner Mangum never had a chance. Goes down at the 18-yard line as Casey Hughes from the corner came unmolested. They've had a variety of those, haven't they?
Yeah, corner blitz, as you see right here, he disguised it well. But still, you've got to be able to see that as quarterback. That's the problem with being underneath the center. Once you take a snap and turn your back, the corner comes, you have no chance.
Great point. And some guys are so focused on the receiver downfield that they don't see it even if they take it in the shotgun.
That's exactly right.
Mangum, draw play. Man, that just went absolutely nowhere. Trey Dye at 5'9", 184. He's not going to run over anybody.
Defensive line looked like they were playing the draw. No pass rush at all. No penetration, just waiting for Dye to run the draw play. Well scouted by the Utah coaches.
Linehan, who blew a fake punt try a week ago deep in his own territory, is back to kick. Hobbs waits for it. Low line drive kick. It takes a good bounce for BYU. In 2 days, you can catch the annual ESPN Week One. Easy for me to say, Monday Night Football doubleheader. Starting at 6:55 Eastern, Drew Brees and the Saints, including Adrian Peterson, are back to his old stomping grounds. You want to read this for me as they take on Sam Bradford and the Vikings. Then Phillip Rivers and the Los Angeles Chargers battle Vaughn Miller and the Broncos. And there is Adrian Peterson. Is there anything left in the tank? The guy was such a great running back.
Oh, what a great player.
But now people hit 30 years old. If you're a running back, it seems to be over for most everybody.
4 minute drill. Let's see what Utah does. Short passing game to the outside. They're not going to huddle. They're probably going to go a little faster than normal. I think they can smell blood a little bit.
Singleton makes the catch. Yeah, they just can't smell points. They've dominated a game, but they can't score. It's the new offensive coordinator, Troy Taylor, the eighth in 9 years for this school.
That was tough on offensive coordinators.
Taylor only had 1 year in college at Eastern Washington after a superb high school career. The strange thing about all these coordinators is that some of them are retired and some of them are just out of football.
And look at those names. Norm Chow, Dennis Erickson, Dave Christensen. Man, what some coaches.
And it just hasn't worked for whatever reason. Boy, nice run by Huntley. Got a first down. Let's go to Card.
Well, Troy Taylor helped at Folsom High School in California. He coached Jake Browning, who's a superstar junior quarterback for the Washington Huskies, and Chris Peterson. Chris Peterson actually recommended him for that offensive coordinator job as we listen to the official.
15-yard penalty. Replay, first down.
And, Mike, he was so impressed with the mind of Troy Taylor when that offensive coordinator job opened at Eastern Washington. He endorsed Troy Taylor, and expect this offense to change with Taylor. At Eastern Washington, he only ran the ball 42% of the time. Last year, Utah, without Troy Taylor, ran the ball 59% of the time.
All right, Paul, and that is a culture change in this offense. Four-man rush, they don't get there. The pass underneath after the penalty will take it out to the 44. They need to reach the 45 of BYU for a first down. Hambly, the tight end, who caught 21 balls a year ago and is now a fifth-year senior, made that grab. On the run, another completion and a big, big stick. Gawuloku.
Number one, way too much cushion out of number five. But he makes a good break on it. Wilson did a good job of holding on to it.
Yes, he did. Third and two. Time becoming a factor. The clock running was set to go under 2 minutes.
Two tight ends in the game. Wonder who's going to run the ball.
There's your answer. And it is just shot. All right, if you're coaching Utah, what do you do here?
You got to go for it.
Even though you're up 6-0.
Well, I mean, all you got to do is run the same formation, pretty much run the same play. They can't stop you for a foot. And the problem that they've had is they're getting penalties in tough situations just like this.
Yes. Good point.
Full house backfield. New set. We haven't seen this. Pistol formation.
And Kyle Whittingham's on the sideline, I think. He saw the clock running down.
Utah, their first charge timeout of the half.
And wanted to grab the timeout with 1:20 to go. They still have two left, and we'll be back in a moment.
Chris Cotter back in Bristol. Jonathan Vilma and Coach Chip Kelly going to join me for the BMW Halftime Report coming up. Wait till you see the job the Sooners did in the shoe against Ohio State. Highlights that one, plus Lamar Jackson had a big day. No huddle, rapid fire highlights and game balls. It's all coming up. BMW Halftime Report. Mike, Tommy, we'll see you then.
Fourth and one, they're out there to go for it. And they got the first down.
Did you see what they did? Quarterback underneath center. I love
How
it.
How about that?
Yeah. But, you know, when you don't do it very often, you really worry about you doing that. Gutsy call. Minute 17.
But you're right. If you know you can make it, you're going to do it, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You're going to see a lot of Tyler Huntley here.
Short set throws complete, and it's Carrington. ...22 yards on that throw. Clock stops temporarily for the first down with a minute left.
BYU's playing a lot of zone coverage.
Huntley swings it in the flat. That's not going to work for more than a couple of yards. You feel the reason they play a lot of zone coverage is they don't have the outside speed to play man.
Utah, their second charge timeout of the half. This will be a 30-second timeout.
I'll ask you that question again in a second. Taco Bell is the proud partner of the college football playoff. You can be on the lookout for Taco Bell student sections and passionate fans like these at games all season long. Is there a speed problem that keeps them from?
Well, probably they might have something to do with it, but they had 35 yards of grass to cover with basically a minute to go. And so they look like they're probably not prevent, but staying in zone and not give them the post route that they gave up earlier over the middle. So I would imagine they would continue to play zone here, but 38 seconds. They've got enough time for number one to run the ball a couple of times and still throw it a couple of times.
And they have a timeout still at their disposal. Good protection. Now Huntley scrambles and smartly throws it away. It'll bring up third down.
They tried to throw to Carrington on the post route and zone coverage, and they had him double covered inside, outside.
Huntley's made some good decisions. Hasn't tried to force it much.
When you're out of the pocket as much as these spread quarterbacks are, you have to make good decisions.
BYU crowd exhorting that defense for a stop. Huntley, a bullet to Carrington inside the five, first and goal, 24 seconds left. Kid really does have an arm.
He puts some smoke on that ball. He continues to, if you notice in this game, he throws most to his right. Of course, that's where Carrington lines up most of the time.
Clock running. Another bad snap. Comes up with it and throws in the corner. Out of bounds. Carrington thought he had it, and there's a flag down as well. Takes the clock all the way down to 11 seconds.
They are absolutely killing themselves with flags, but
holding offense number one, 10-yard penalty, replay first down.
Tyler Huntley was called for holding. How's that possible? He threw the ball.
They have got to press number nine. Corner's got to get on top of him. Don't let him off the line of scrimmage.
First and goal with 11 seconds left. But they push him back. This one batted down to the line of scrimmage. 7 seconds to go. There have been 7 flags against Utah for 80 yards. 6 of them have come on offense.
One more quick snap, and BYU is going to get out of this thing again.
It's amazing.
Without giving up a touchdown.
I mean, they could easily be down by 4 scores at this point.
All right, you got 7 seconds. You can't take the ball outside with a quarterback. He'll forget the time on the clock.
But the good news for the Cougars, they're only down by 2 field goals. Time's going to run out if he doesn't get this pass off. It's too high.
Goodness.
1 second on the clock so they can go for a field goal. That was a break for Utah.
Well, Troy Taylor made the right call. Stay in the pocket, throw the ball down the field. Unfortunately, he didn't tell him not to scramble. He scrambled outside and almost the clock ran out on him.
Now, if you're the home team coach, Tommy, don't you expect that clock to take one more tick?
You would think.
They do convert, however. Gay is perfect this year. 21-25 and 31 tonight. Nine nothing Utah. Our halftime score. Now let's send you to Chris Cotter for the BMW Halftime Report. Welcome back to ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by GEICO. It is 9-0 here. Utah with the lead at Brigham Young. With all these iconic shots in Provo, Utah. The score could be much bigger at this point.
Execution has not been a premium in offense.
No, it hasn't. And here are the mistakes, Coach.
2 touchdowns called back. Got an interception here. Here we've got a pick play. BYU, they get a touchdown, but you can't screen on a pick play. Easy call by the official. And we turn around and we do it on the other end. Utah does the same thing. He tries to pivot out of it. It's what you teach. But still, he went straight to the guy and screened him out. You can't do that. Easy call by the official. Very both, ragged game so far.
Both coaches disagreed with the calls, but they were both so obvious.
Yep. All right. Different formation here out of BYU. See if they change their tactics.
Got a bunch right. Mangum back to throw. Has pressure in his face. Throws underneath for a short game.
If I was BYU, I would up the tempo a little bit. I'd get the crowd involved. They got to get the crowd involved. Home field, rival game. They want something to scream about. There you see Ty Detmer, offensive coordinator, won the Heisman Trophy here. A lot of pressure on him here, being offensive coordinator.
He wants to run that pro-style attack. He's got a pro-style quarterback in Tanner Mangum, who is not all that mobile. Off the right side, breaking the tackle for about 4 yards. Kavika Fanoa. You talked about maybe increasing the tempo. As a coach, if A, B, and C aren't working, you've got to find D, E, and F, don't you?
Yeah, and we're going to find out what Ty Detmer does second half. He's changed up the formations, but I would change the tempo just a little bit. And I know they do it. I've seen them in practice. I'd do something to change the tempo to where you get the fans involved. We got to have some kind of motivation.
3rd and 3. Sustaining a drive would really help these guys keep their defense off the field for a while. Maybe produce some points. Pressure coming, and the ball's batted down at the line of scrimmage and picked off. Mono Fisi, the tackle, had that ball bounce right in his lap, and it's Utah football.
when you've got to throw the ball on third and two as much as BYU's had to in the first couple of games, bad things happen. And as we see it right here, unfortunately, batted down. Good pass rush, good penetration. Gets his hands up, goes right to 45, makes the interception.
Nice catch.
Yeah.
Filippo Macco Fisi.
He'll always remember that. Interception
in
the Holy War. Well, here we go. Let's see if they can take advantage. They hadn't done it all night long.
Mangum talking to Ty on the sideline. And they start from the 25-yard line. Huntley forced out of the pocket and throws it away. Young man's made a lot of good decisions in this game. Let's go to Clark.
Well, Mike, moments ago when Utah took the field, I ran on the field with Coach Kyle Whittingham. Before I asked him a question, he said, "We need to score in the red zone." I said, "How are you going to do it? Where are the opportunities?" And he said he doesn't care if it's in the passing game or the running game, but defensively he's thrilled because he feels he's making BYU one-dimensional by shutting down the run.
Well, he is doing that, Paul. Post inside the five. Great throw and a catch by Carrington. What a bullet by Huntley.
And pressure in his face. They run a corner fire. He sees him coming. He's got his face to him. He didn't come from the boundary. And he makes a great throw down the middle. This kid's got hands. He's got triple X gloves that he wears, Carrington.
Just that envelops
is,
the ball.
That is huge hands. And he runs with authority. He runs with his height. A lot of receivers don't run tall. He's tall and he runs tall.
He's the second team all Pac-12. It's a sophomore at Oregon.
Busted play.
Huntley takes advantage anyway. There was nobody there when he turned around, so what the heck, I'll do it myself.
Nothing else worked. Might as well have a busted play and score. Watch this. The backs go opposite. Number two knows he's going the wrong way. Touchdown.
He just got great quickness. Very shifty when he runs. And now Matt Gay will come on for the point after. It is still a two-touchdown game at 16-0, but BYU has shown very little evidence that they can get two touchdowns on this bunch.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by the all-new Volkswagen Tiguan, the new king of the concrete jungle.
It's the Monty L. Bean Life Science Museum on campus with plant and animal research that's gone on there for nearly 40 years. BYU in a lot of trouble right now as they haven't been able to move the ball. Tomorrow morning, why not start your NFL Week 1 with ESPN's NFL Countdown at a new time, 10 Eastern, a new team, including Rex Ryan and the new host, Samantha Ponder. That's tomorrow morning at 10 on ESPN, as well as streaming live on the ESPN app. Good luck, Sam. Have a great show.
Two interceptions. Turns into 10 points. New quarterback.
Bateman is the transfer from Alabama, listed as the third team quarterback for this ball club. Mangum throws out in the flat. They'll pick up about five. Nice solid tackle there.
Good play to pull a new quarterback in, get him out of the pocket.
Marquise Blair came up from the safety spot, number 13. Second and five. Mangum throws again. A little bit of contact there. No flag. And Jalen Johnson, the backup corner, is right on top of the play. Doesn't seem to be a lot of deception in this passing game. They're staring down receivers.
Yeah, it's all quick game. I don't remember one deep throw. But they might not have enough time to throw it down there. Just
going to say, it's tough to call them when you can't protect the guy.
To this point, they're just getting out of athlete on the outside.
Right. Third and five. They can ill afford a three and out and give it back to Utah at this point. And that will be enough for a first down. Good throw there. Good patience by Mangum. And Bushman, the tight end, their leading receiver, made the catch. He's made four grabs in this game. And they're out to the 43.
Looking for
a little line. BYU cut into this lead.
Yeah. They've got to make something happen. They're going to run out of time. They've got to get the fans involved.
Again, underneath. Hefo makes the catch, and Utah, the kind of the defense they're playing right now, they're going to say, you're going to have to get this 5 yards at a time. That's all we're going to give you. Mangum may have had his arm hit when he let that go, and it's intercepted. Picked off by Johnson. Well, another big mistake is it looked like his arm was impacted as he was throwing, although it went way downfield. And he said, yeah, that's what happened. Hit my arm. Another BYU mistake. And Johnson had better position than the wide receiver. Kylie Fitz, the senior defensive end who had 7 sacks 2 years ago, spent most of last season injured, made the play on this last sequence that allowed them to get the ball back. He's the left defensive end, and watch him hit Mangum's elbow just as he throws.
First of all, Pitts gets a great jump, 71 slow off the ball. You can tell Mangum's got no chance. He can't get to his front foot. He can't get anything on the ball. Defensive back turns into the receiver.
Shumway was outside. The ball came down inside, and it was an easy pick. Fitz is playmaker. 11:27 on the third quarter clock. And another fumble, and BYU has it. Fred Warner charging into the backfield, comes up with the ball. What is that, 5 low snaps?
Unbelievable. Only way they get back in this game is turn the ball over. Just a bad, it's just a bad handoff, bad read. You can tell he gets the snaps. He puts the ball in the breadbasket, but he pulls it out, loses the handle on it. And that's one thing about this offense. I mean, you're going to make mistakes. There's a lot of technique to it. There wasn't any technique on that handoff. Fred Warner is always around the ball.
May the center forgive me, because that was not a bad snap. Now BYU has to take advantage of this opportunity. Great field position at the 22-yard line. Straight up the middle goes the big guy, Tolu Tau. All 255 pounds of him out of Glendale, Utah.
Now we're picking the tempo up. Here we go. Speed it up a little bit.
He originally signed with Wisconsin, went on his mission, and decided he was going to go to BYU. And that pass broken up by Julian Blackman. What a play by the corner, as that ball may have also been tipped at the line of scrimmage.
The receivers tend to be falling coming off the line of scrimmage. BYU's receivers, their routes don't look very crisp. They're not playing very tall.
19 drives without points. Third and 2. Mangum hands it off. Down to the 2-yard line goes Tolu Tau. 6'1", 255, has had shin problems. He's okay now. And what a difference he makes rumbling through that line. Ball spotted just outside the one. Big guy's got it again, lowers his shoulder, pushed back this time.
Same play, inside zone, just got no push. Mangum could have pulled the ball and walked in the end zone, but it must have been called from the sideline to hand it off.
Loa Fatatonga is the guy who filled that hole and made the tackle. He was number five for the Utes.
Tejan Peroni, the center, made a very good block on the play before that. Now he's got to get more push here.
Movement up front. BYU says Utah moved first.
Delay of game. Defense number 93. Signals intended to draw the offense into a false start. Half the distance to the goal. Second down.
Lotulale is called for the penalty. He's been on first, second, or third team Pac-12 for 3 years.
Senior defensive tackle. Watch the movement. Comes inside.
Well, that's a tough
call,
isn't it?
Yeah, that's a tough call.
The big man gets the first points in a long, long time. Almost a game and three quarters. This guy's got a future as a back. He can run at 255. Go for two here, coach.
Going for two.
You like this call?
Well, it might be a little bit too early, but they're probably going off the card. You have a card in the press box that you look at, and they tell you whether go for one or two, what quarter you're in, how much time left in the game. This will put them one score behind.
Don't you also have to think about how many more opportunities you might get?
Yeah.
They went for two.
And ran quarterback draw.
And ran last quarterback year, draw, didn't make it. See what Mangum comes up with this time. Mangum rolls, trying to keep it alive. Jump ball in the back of the end zone and incomplete. There is a flag down.
That play was disaster from the beginning.
After all that time, you would think it's a hold, but we'll check.
Normally what you do is you have a two-point play, one, two, or three, that you run depending on what's happened during the game. You work that all week long. Then you have some kind of continuity. You're just not grab-bagging a play.
You keep that on your chart the same way you do everything
else? During the play, personal foul, illegal block below the waist, offense number 59. This penalty is declined. The try is no good. The kickoff will be from the 35-yard line.
Thomas Schoaf, the sophomore left tackle, they'll decline it. But the Cougars get six and get themselves back in this ball game. 16-6 with the emergence of Tolu Tau. All 255 pounds of him. What's at stake here? Utah could make it seven straight in this series. They haven't done that since 1957. BYU, first series win since 2009, and the first one against Utah under Kalani Sitake. Fultz, the deep man from the goal line. Cut down shy of the 15-yard line. Good coverage by BYU. Tomorrow night at 8 Eastern on ESPN, Sunday Night Baseball will be in Cleveland as the Indians, white hot, look for their 18th straight to host the Orioles. Coverage begins at 7 o'clock with baseball tonight. Sunday Night Countdown, both streaming live on the ESPN app. The Indians trying to catch the Astros for American League home field advantage. So we've had the Astros, who were the hottest team on earth for a while. Then the Dodgers, who eclipsed that. They were the best team in the universe. And now it's the Indians.
Utah's just got to get back to basic plays.
Huntley throws underneath, and that BYU defense certainly seeming more aggressive right now.
That's one of the first RPOs I've seen tonight. Run pass option. Kid does it pretty good in practice. That's where they stick the ball in the belly of the back, either give it, pull it out, and throw it. And with Carrington on the right side, that's always a good play.
Throw near the first down sticks. It looks like it's going to be just shy. C.O.C. Wilson, the sophomore receiver, made the catch. They have a slew of 6'2 and 6'3 receivers. Tell you what, Huntley has arm talent. Trying to get that first down, and they can't. BYU comes up with a stop, and look at the emotion from these kids.
Number 95 of BYU has to leave the game. His helmet came off.
Kyrus Tonga, 95, is somebody you can't help rooting for. He was thrown out of high school for discipline problems. He was homeless on the street. Finally, a friend of his family adopted him, and this young man has turned his life around. And he has got a brilliant future as a defensive lineman. Jacobson takes it at the 26-yard line. Another 52-yard line. Now let's take a look at this week's college football playoff rankings, brought to you by Capital One. Bama used Fresno State today. Look at Oklahoma. Knocks off Ohio State. Auburn loses 14-6 to Clemson. Penn State was impressive against Pitt. USC, very impressive against number 14, Stanford. Washington, Michigan, Florida Atlantic all win. FSU canceled by the problems generated by that massive hurricane.
And Ohio State just gave up so many yards in the passing game. Their defensive back really got exposed.
Mangum under pressure. Down he goes. Cody Barton, who is listed as a backup linebacker, but is the second leading tackler on this ball club, got him on the blitz.
Quick passing game, three-step drop. They covered the slant. Nowhere to throw it. Nothing to do but eat the ball.
Tried to run it with Mangum. That was a good ball fake on his part.
That was the same play we were talking about on the goal line.
Yes, it was.
Where he didn't pull it out on the goal line, but he does here. He's going to have to run the ball some. I know they don't want him to run it, but they got to make a factor out of him in the offense.
Coming into this game, he had only carried the ball 8 times, some of them on sacks, and lost 22 yards. But the element of surprise may help him, certainly. And now Mangum takes off again. Dive does not get there. Maybe the length of a football short, depending on the mark.
I think you got to go for it. Of course, that's me. That's me, the Mississippi River.
Well, you're the riverboat gambler, so.
You're not going to get that many chances.
Mangum gave it his best effort. But they will send on the punting unit. Linehan, the rugby-style kicker.
Poor first down play. Gave away the sack. Put him in a hole.
Tough to dig out of a hole like that, too. Especially with their style of offense. It is not a big play group. Good coverage there. 51-yard kick. A loss of 3 on the return. at BYU last season's poinsettia bowl game against Wyoming. Hanneman was ejected for targeting on a helmet-to-helmet hit on sliding Cowboy quarterback Josh Allen. Then last week, he hit Tigers running back Darius Geis with the crown of his helmet. He was ejected from that game. He is a solid player in the secondary. Started pass at the last moment, complete out to the 30.
Some people ask why you run the spread.
Siosi Wilson with his fifth catch. And there is a flag down on the play.
There's no foul for an eligible receiver downfield. The result of the play is a first down.
There's Micah Hanneman, the senior, who is eligible to play here in the second half, but has not appeared as yet. First and 10. Huntley out in the flat to McCormick, and McCormick cut down. Nice tackle by John Loku.
A lot of safe plays. Play before this, the quarterback did a great job of making a big play out of a bad play. And that's what the spread offense does. It puts an athletic player on the field, a quarterback. When the play breaks down, as it does quite a bit of time, he makes a play with his legs, gets the ball either down the field or runs it, keeps the ball alive.
Good fake and another good throw complete out to midfield. This young man really has played well at the quarterback spot. Damari Simpkins, his wide receiver from high school, and now there's another flag down.
It's number 79. 5-yard penalty. Replay. Second down.
Angasiva, the junior Calais transfer right guard, called for the penalty.
That's a call they're wanting to make by the rules committee. Don't let the lineman go down the field on these RPOs where it's a play-action pass, run, or throw. These linemen continue to go down the field. If they go past 3 yards, it's illegal to receive downfield.
And it's become a point of emphasis because it was really being abused.
Yes.
Utah's been hit for 9 penalties, 85 yards. Zing. Over the middle. Arm strength is not a problem for this guy, is it?
He can throw off his back foot. He doesn't have a real quick release. He has a windup, as you can see right here. Just a perfect throw in the middle of the field. I'm sure they want him to continue to try to stay in the pocket as much as possible. You know, when you've got receivers like he's got, you need to use the entire field. Don't let the field cut in half when you break out of the pocket and run to one side. He's got a lot of receivers he can throw to. He's got some big receivers, and he's got a good slot.
Nearly 300 yards in total offense for this young man. 225 passing, 19 out of 25.
And Utah has taken their first timeout of the half.
So they beat the clock. It will be first and 10 when we come back in a 16-6 game.
Streaming live on the ESPN app. Download now and take ESPN everywhere.
Welcome back to Provo, Utah, where the Holy War is being played between Utah and Brigham Young. The Utes have the advantage right now, 16-6. The time winding down in the third quarter. And Utah in Brigham Young territory. safety valve out there, complete to Simpkins. They'll pick up a couple.
Another RPO to the outside. I mean, this kid has really got a, again, not a quick release, but he's got a, he can throw the ball across the field. That's what it takes when you play in the spread offense. You throw a lot of 40-yard passes that are only 5-yard out routes.
If this is Troy Taylor, the offensive coordinator in his first year, Tommy, if you were building an offense from scratch, would this be the kind of thing you'd be looking for?
I would have a mixture of both of these. I think there's a reason you need both. Sometimes you need to go into a game and protect the quarterback against a strong defense, to be able to protect by your offensive line, to be able to protect blitzes and things like that. But I like an active quarterback. And so this is the type of kid that you want. But this is the offense that high schools are running all over the country.
Yes, sir. That's for sure. BYU jumps.
Here's a freeze play.
And they'll throw it out of bounds. That should cost the Cougars 5 yards.
Oh, that was a big third down play, too.
Offside, defense number 95 in the neutral zone. 5-yard penalty results in a first down.
Kyrus Tonga.
Freeze play is a quick count where you try to draw the defense off. If they jump, you snap the ball, you get a 5-yard penalty, but you also throw it, possibly a completion. If not, you change the play at the line of scrimmage.
Little trickery. Simpkins wants to throw. Boy, he's got an arm, too. He zipped that one in there to Nakua. There's another big receiver at 6'3".
Looks like a reverse. Probably a play they ran at Hollandale High School.
Probably.
As a duo. You can do a lot of things in spread offense. And Troy Taylor's pulling out all stops now. They're running every formation, every play that they've worked on in practice.
This is going to make Kyle Whittingham very happy with his choice of offensive coordinators this year. Check out the flag.
Could be a legal receiver downfield. Again, that's what you get on all these
RPOs.
There's
no foul for intentional, there's no foul for an ineligible receiver downfield. The quarterback legally grounded the ball. Second down.
That's a new one.
I was going to say, I don't remember hearing that exact verbiage.
Forward pass, illegal receiver downfield, but he grounded it, and so it's no penalty. Left, look that one up.
It was like the holding call on the quarterback. Yeah. We're going to have to take a closer look at that. Boy, almost picked. Nice defense by the middle linebacker, Butch Powell.
As you can tell, the quarterback scrambles on the last play. You got offensive lineman downfield. He throws the ball away. Again, that's a hard one to explain.
It's a pass, isn't it?
Pass down the field, yes.
Allowing a substitution here. Third and 10.
Huge, huge play for BYU's defense.
Huntley with time for the end zone. Was he in? No. Wilson is saying he caught it.
That ball was in the air almost 45 yards. No, stand
out of bounds. Just had his left toe on the line. Remember in college football, 1 foot in is good. But the right foot had come up, and the left foot touched the line. 38-yard field goal try here. As Gay is 3 for 3 tonight, make it 4 for 4. And on the season, he's hit all 7 tries. and it's 19-6. Tomorrow afternoon, the U.S. Open Men's Championship between number one seed Rafael Nadal, a 15-time major winner, including two U.S. Opens, and South African Kevin Anderson. You can catch it at 4 Eastern on ESPN, as well as streaming live on the app. And he would pull within 3 of Roger Federer. A lot of people thought Pete Sampras would never be passed.
Those are some great athletes.
Aren't they? Their endurance is just off the charts.
And they play for years.
Yes.
BYU's 2 touchdowns down. They've got to open up the offense, but they've got to protect Mangum.
Wisnowski to kick it away. A yard deep, they'll bring it out. And a great return out near midfield. Trinneman, wide receiver, goes 45 yards.
Excellent job of the returner setting it up in the middle. But you can tell number 33, the kicker right here, he's had a great day of kicking. He's also had a great day of tackling, or that would have been 7 points.
The guys on the outside lost contain. Everybody pinched toward the middle, and it was off to the races for him. First team junior college All-American at Snow College last year. If you're BYU, you're not going to get that many more opportunities. They need 2 touchdowns. They're going to have to take advantage of this field position. Mangum goes for the deep ball and overthrown by maybe a foot to Bo Tanner, and Tanner a little slow getting up.
That's a good safe play, though. They're playing, Utah's playing man coverage. They're pressing the receivers. Hey, it's just a foot race. Take a 3-step drop, throw a fade route. They need a cheap touchdown. They need to get a touchdown before this quarter's over with to get back in the game.
Good coverage by Casey Hughes. Off the right side, the 255-pound tailback, Tulo Ta'u. Cody Barton made the stop. There is a marker down.
Holding offense number 78. 10-yard penalty. Replay, 2nd down.
Tooney Kanuch, the senior right guard. And that's a huge hold call.
Chase Hansen, strong safety, was up on the line of scrimmage. Some reason, you know, he was pressing the tight end. I think he thought they were going to throw the tight end. But they continue to just dig themselves a hole. Second 20. I'm going to let you call this play, Mike.
No thanks. This is not a 2nd and 20 offense. This is a 2nd and 6 offense. Mangum hit just before he throws. Picks up about 5.
He had plenty
of
time.
Out of the backfield by Trey Dye.
Nobody open. Man covers. They're just all over him. You know, they're not defending the field at all. Utah just getting up on the receivers, bumping them. They're just saying, hey, we're better athletes than you are.
97 total yards a week ago. They've been held to 159 tonight. Neither is anything to write home about. 3rd and 18. Clock ticking. Blitz coming. Mangum throws off his back foot and throws it away. The receiver went inside, he threw outside, and it's time for the punt team to come on for BYU.
Kyle Willingham has made a point of recruiting athletes. And you can tell they've done a good job of going to California, Florida, Texas, doing a good job of bringing in guys that can run and make plays. BYU is going to have to make a decision on what offense they want to run and what type of quarterbacks they're going to play with.
An old saying that speed kills, it still does.
No substitute.
Hobbs. for a nice cut. Good, tough return. 11 yards after a kick of 53. Nice night for Tyler Huntley. 306 yards in total offense through three quarters. Tough kid.
He's strong. You can tell he's strong. He can make moves. And he didn't go down. A lot of these spread quarterbacks just go down on the run. He can throw the ball over the middle. He can throw it deep. He can make you miss.
And he's got arm talent galore. Nice throw there out in the flat. Extra effort by Nakua. And let's go to Clark.
Well, Coach, you mentioned the athletes. Huntley from Florida. Maybe the best athlete on the field is number nine, Darren Carrington. Coach, another thing you said earlier, his hands, extra large gloves he wears. The two other things that really separate this kid, I had an opportunity to talk to the Oregon transfer this week, and he told me it's the Mamba mentality, like Kobe Bryant, the desire to be the best. And he emulates everything Kobe does on the basketball court, and also is a student of the game, watches a ton of old film. Guys like Jerry Rice and Tim Brown in regards to their routes and their progressions. This kid's the real deal.
And Clark, people don't succeed unless they work at it and work hard, because there are so many guys out there with talent. You're trying to separate yourself from everybody else. That's the end of the third quarter. Utah with the lead. Welcome back to Provo, getting ready to start the fourth quarter as BYU trails the visiting Utah Utes. Nakua has been very active in the second half. Five catches overall.
Tanner Jacobson on the tackle. That's just a little bubble screen uncovered. They actually had a running play call there, and you saw the guy uncovering throw. That's how much progress Huntley has made just in his second game as a true starter.
Good point. You have to hope for football smarts out of your quarterback. And he's displayed him. Huntley, look at the power of this kid. 190 pounds, he just drives forward and gets the first down. Not afraid of contact either.
No, he never goes backwards. He's good body length. He uses his linemen. He knows he's not that strong in terms of taking on defensive linemen and linebackers, but you know, he's not afraid of it. And I like that about him. He's a tough kid. He reminds me a lot of Lamar Jackson, that this is the same offense.
Yep.
You know, the same offense. It's kind of the same style. You know, he doesn't have the explosion that he has, but
right.
He has a lot of similarities.
Put his hand on Jackson Barton's back and just followed him to pick up enough yardage for the first down.
Troy Taylor's probably going to dial up some running plays now to try to run the clock. I was looking at this. Darren Carrington, number nine, had five catches for 77 yards, four plays over 15 yards, and he had 10 catches last week. Pretty good offseason acquisition by Kyle Whittingham.
Special talent there, there's no doubt about it. Quarterback keeper.
Read all the way, reading the defensive end. They probably averaged 6 or 7 yards on that play tonight. This is what they ran on the first series.
Now keep in mind, this kid only played enough to throw 7 passes last year, run the ball 9 times, because Troy Williams was the starter and went 9-4, passed for almost 2,800 yards.
He beat out a senior quarterback. That's
yep.
What's amazing.
His job now. And another first down. And you just hear the clock tick, tick, tick.
Good movement up front by the offensive line. This offense gives your offensive lineman a chance, too. You don't have to be perfect. You know, it's not really a power game. It's a finesse game. Puts the ball in the hands of the quarterback. Gives you an opportunity to make decisions. As we saw earlier, you can make decisions and bad technique, such as this, put the ball on the ground and make mistakes.
Turns it into a positive anyway.
No pressure out of the D-line. Harrington gets his sixth catch of the day off a bad snap and just a flick of the arm by the quarterback. This kid's got a future.
Yes, he does. He's the Florida Gatorade Player of the Year in 2015 at Hallandale.
Like I said, he flew over a lot of schools to get here.
And they're very grateful. McCormick driving forward. Tomorrow morning, you can kick off your NFL Week 1 with ESPN Sunday NFL Countdown at a new time, 10 Eastern, and the new team, including Rex Ryan, our new host, Samantha Ponder. That's tomorrow morning at 10 on ESPN, as well as streaming live on the ESPN app. A cast of thousands to be with you on Sunday NFL Countdown as the NFL season gets started in earnest. Can't wait. Huntley with time. He obviously has that clock in his head that we always talk about for quarterbacks.
And you can't teach that.
No. He's looking downfield, all at once. His mind tells him, uh-oh, time to get rid of it. And he knows where those outlet guys are.
You can see here, he looks downfield. He's thinking about going deep and just drops it off. I mean, it's got to be automatic in this offense because you're not going to get a lot of deep throws unless you run play action, unless you've got four wide receivers. That was a two-receiver route. Just dumped it off to his back.
Third and inches. And another first down. McCormick, did he fumble? He did. BYU with a huge break as Troy Warner, the younger brother of star linebacker Fred Warner, came up and helped make the play. That ball is out. Fred Warner initially makes the tackle, and his brother Troy got the ball. Huge break for BYU.
ESPN's College Football is presented by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. And in part by the Lexus IS350, IS all-wheel drive, and IS turbo. Experience amazing.
The Velour Live Music Gallery is a nearby venue that local Provo bands Neon Trees and Imagine Dragons made their bones on their way to becoming international stars. I know Paul Carcaterra has streamed all that music. And here's that fumble. They reviewed it, and it was clearly a fumble, and it was recovered by BYU. Now, can the Cougars make something out of it? Down two scores. Two touchdowns with 10:39 left. Mangum had a man, but overthrew him by a step and a half. Hefo looked like a skinny post, and he missed him.
Yep. They're just playing man free and just run by the guy. I mean, Booby Hobbs has got to get his feet out of the ground and cover the guy. Here we go back to last play, but again, they're playing man coverage with a two-touchdown lead, and they know they're going to throw the ball down the field. I would think I'd play a little bit of zone defense.
Hefo sort of bent that pattern to the outside, and the ball was thrown a little more inside. See if Utah was outside, I think, or offside, I think they were. We will check the penalty. They'll get to do this over, perhaps.
BYU's version of the freeze play. Draw them off sides, throw it deep.
Chase Hansen, the safety. The veteran back there, the only starter
offside
from a year ago.
Defense number 11. 5-yard penalty. Replay, 4th down.
If you're expecting BYU to make a comeback, look at these stats. Mangum this half, 5 out of 12, only 23 yards and 2 picks. He's got to pick his game up to give them a chance.
Third down.
Mangum looking downfield, nailed and sacked. I was going to say maybe they're thinking about if they don't get it here to go on fourth down, but not after that play.
They was trying to get it to the tight end Bushman. They put him in motion, just try to get him away from man coverage. And
Moko Fisi got the sack.
Just watch the coverage. They put him in motion. Everybody's covered. Nowhere to throw it. Covered sack.
Everybody's blanketed. Hobbs on the return, and Utah dodges a bullet there. Beautiful Provo, the campus of BYU, but their guys are down by 2 touchdowns. The 2012 Holy War was a strange game. 3 different strange endings. After a BYU incompletion, the Utah crowd rushed the field thinking they'd won. But there was a second left on the clock. BYU then tries a 51-yard field goal to tie it, and it was blocked. But the crowd rushed the field too soon in the end zone, and the Utes were given a 15-yard penalty. So BYU had another chance to tie the game, but Riley Stevens' 36-yard field goal hit the upright, and the crowd rushed the field finally and permanently for a 24-21 win. They got tuckered out rushing the field. Paul Carcaterra was there, so Paul, you almost got run over 3 times.
Yeah, tuckered out. I was the guy who was tuckered out as well. That was an amazing ending. When it finally ended the 3rd time they rushed the field, I didn't even believe that it was over. I had to pinch myself. But I'll never forget that night, too. And I remember the producer in my ear, make sure you get Coach. Oh, yeah, it's going to be really easy to find Coach here. Somehow I was able to get Kyle Whittingham, and I'll tell you what, as Carrington looks like he's off to the races.
What a throw. Man, that was beautiful.
That was pretty unusual. Watch Carrington. He's a trail receiver. He's trying to get the ball deep to the inside receiver. Play action pass. He looks deep, but Carrington's following him up. Gets the ball to him. I think it was a busted play. Very good busted play.
Just a bullet for 41 yards. Carrington, 7 catches, 129 yards. He is legit on the outside.
Last week they played him only on the right side. Tonight they moved him back and forth so you can't zero in on him.
Quarterback keeper to the 23. Paul, you want to finish that story?
I finally found Kyle Whittingham, and it was a memorable night for sure. And I'll tell you what, when we got the assignment a couple weeks ago that we were coming out to Provo for this game, I knew the magnitude of this rivalry. A lot of times, unless you live it, Coach, you lived Auburn, Alabama. You hear Utah, BYU, you might not really understand the significance until you live it. So saw it firsthand, was pumped to come back out.
Whatever your rivalry is the biggest one in the country.
That's exactly right.
Second and 5. We're using up the play clock as much as possible to let that game clock run. Here's the all-time series, 59-34-4 for Utah. Teams do not disagree on what the record is or when it started, because BYU used to be called the Brigham Young Academy, and they don't count those games. So that will never be resolved. Third and five. Oh, just milking that play clock. Huntley slides. He's going to be short. Boy, they gave him a great spot. The second official came in, but the first marked it back at the 19-yard line. They need to get to the 17.
Look how he accelerates around the corner. You know, he's going to give a lot of people problems as long as he can hold on to the ball.
A field goal here gives you a virtually insurmountable lead. And Kyle Whittingham says, look, I want to
run the clock down.
I want to get
the
all the way
goal.
Down. Yeah. Right. You'd be up 22-16.
And the field goal guy's perfect for
yes.
the last two games.
And it's two touchdowns
Utah,
and two-point conversions just to tie. So they call timeout, 5:59 left.
Let's take a look at the last third down at Huntley. He wants to throw the ball down the field. It's third and eight. He could have made the first down. He's a little bit disgusted. You could tell by looking at him. He wanted to make the first down. He went down a little too early.
They'll pass on the field goal and go for it on fourth down. And not make it. BYU's defense rises to the occasion again. I understand why they went for it, but I'm surprised they didn't kick the field goal.
Yeah, sometimes you get greedy, but sometimes also in a rivalry game, you look at points. Sometimes that makes a difference. I've been there, done that. I would have kicked the field goal. But a great play out of BYU. They made a lot of penetration on the right side. I was surprised he handed the ball off. I thought he'd keep it.
I did too. He's been so successful with that, but that's the way he read it. First time they have failed in the red zone. But only 5:51 left for the Cougars. Langdon comes out throwing. They'll give them all the five-yard tosses they want.
They've got to go hurry up now. Last seven drives, they've got 53 yards, two first downs, and two turnovers. Not very good percentage.
Blitz coming. Langdon steps up enough, throws almost picked.
Almost every time they run that safety blitz, it's almost been intercepted. Chase Hansen almost gets to him here again. It looks like he does hit his arm. Sooner or later, we'll put a back out there to block him. This offense is built to block that. There's a mistake somewhere along either the line of scrimmage, back or tight end, not picking up the blitz.
Well, if there's no back back there, it's the quarterback's responsibility, isn't it?
To throw hot.
Right.
But there is a back. He stepped up into the line of scrimmage. Maybe they should have moved the offensive line to the left.
Pressure coming again. Steps up and throws. Complete down near the 42-yard line. Bo Tanner made the catch.
That was one of his better throws.
Yes, it was.
Spun the ball well. He had a lot on it. About a 30-yard throw for a 6-yard gain.
A deep throw, and he got it this time to Bushman, who's his favorite receiver, and the big tight end has outstanding hands.
Boy,
five catches for him.
He threw it over two people. You can see right here, most people wouldn't have thrown this ball, but when you've got a 6'6 tight end, take your chances when you need a touchdown.
He's out of Tucson, Arizona, one of the most athletic big guys on this team. Mangum again has it batted back down, and it was Filippo Mocofisi got his hands up. It's about the third good play he's made inside. This club produces a lot of linemen, both defensively and offensively. And he is sucking air right now.
Kyle Willingham told me about 3 years ago he put a major emphasis on bringing in defensive linemen. And the ones that couldn't play defensive line, he moved them to offensive line.
Morgan Scally, the defensive coordinator, got to be proud of his kids tonight. Mangum steps up again and throws incomplete. Excellent coverage by Johnson. The crowd didn't like it. They want a flag, but he was right there.
It looked like good coverage. Their receivers are not quite as big as Utah's receivers, and that's paid dividends for the team in red tonight.
That's just a good play.
Good play.
Hefo was the receiver. Third and 10. Obviously, this is four down territory. Mangum trying to keep the play alive. Throws back against the grain and gets the first down. Nice pass to Bo Tanner.
He strung the play out going to the right. Again, throwing back against the grain, that's awfully tough. He does have a strong arm.
Four-man front. Mangum just off the fingertips of Neil Powell. That was a catchable ball and a heck of a throw by Tanner Mangum.
Stop and go. Defensive back looks back inside too quick. I think I'd let him throw it in front of me instead of over top of if I'm in a situation like this. You can see here Johnson lets him stop and go him, lets him run by. They're going to give him a quick touchdown here in a minute if they don't get into some zone. Again, they're playing man coverage. They're just challenging the receivers.
They dump it off underneath. That's another first down. Nice effort by Trey Dye out of the backfield. This is much more of a receiver out of the backfield than he is a running back.
One of the better drives they've had. They've mixed it up. Throwing the ball deep, throwing it short.
Go with a running play. Uses up a lot of time, though. Remember, they need two scores.
Here comes a big boy in the game, a running back.
Tolu Tau, 255 pounds. Doesn't look that heavy, does it?
No, he doesn't.
He looks like he's in shape. They'll send him out of the backfield. He's wide open, and Mangum missed him as he rolled out to the right. I'm going to use him as a receiver, and boy, he was open in the middle of the field. Now there's a flag down.
Could be a hold on the defense.
Now it looks like they sent him into the game specifically to run that play.
Before the pass, holding defense number 22. The penalty is half the distance from the goal. Automatic first down.
That's Chase Hansen. 11 penalties against Utah. 95 yards. They have specialized in shooting themselves in the foot tonight.
That means they're averaging 11 a game, because that's how many they had last week. Too many fumbles, too many busted plays for Utah. And obviously, way too many penalties.
It's really unacceptable, and usually comes back to bite you. First and goal. Mangum.
Great protection.
Guns to the end zone, and it's a touchdown. Caught by Trey Dye. Credit the offensive line and then Mangum for being able to keep the play alive. And now with the extra point, they'd only be down by six. This is absolutely amazing, isn't it?
Watch, he scrambles out of the pocket. Good receivers when the quarterback's scrambling and needs some help. you go back to the ball. And that's what Trey does here. Makes the play, throw and catch.
Now there's going to be a decision to be made, Tommy. Do you go for an onside kick with 2:38 on the clock, or do you hope that your defense can stop them when it really hasn't stopped them all night long?
Yeah, they've got a few minutes to think about that. It's tough when you're right on the line. Two and a half, three minutes, three timeouts. You've got a chance to get the ball back. But rival game. If you do kick it off, you better play real good defense.
And they've got three timeouts to use. So assuming they can hold them to small games, they could call timeout on first, second, and third down and get the ball back. But they'd have to stop them. Mangum keeps this game alive. In 2 days, catch the annual ESPN Week 1 Monday Night Football doubleheader starting at 6:55 Eastern. Drew Brees and the Saints, including Adrian Peterson, will take on Sam Bradford and the Vikings in Peterson's old stomping grounds. And at 10:15, Phillip Rivers and the Los Angeles Chargers will battle Von Miller and the Broncos. Flag is down on the kickoff.
No onside
kick. Kickoff out of bounds, kicking team. The ball will be placed at the 35-yard line. First down.
And Utah was taking no chances on a return. They did not hit anyone deep. It has been a great night, Coach, for Tyler Huff.
Give him the ball. I'm saying he's going to be a heck of a player. He's going to get bigger and stronger. He's going to learn this offense. He's going to learn not to throw it up for grabs like that sometimes. Sometimes it's good for you. Sometimes it's bad. Busted play. He makes a touchdown. He makes big plays out of bad plays. Look at his numbers. 297 yards passing, 89 yards rushing, one rushing touchdown. 2 minutes and 38 seconds. I'd never take the ball out of his hand for the next three or four plays.
And with that, almost unbelievably, BYU still has a shot. They'll hand it off and not get very much there as Moss gets the carry.
You got to think you type timeouts here pretty quick. Probably one more play. They'll run it under 2 minutes. Then you start your timeouts. That's a pretty good play. Second and eight. Now you force Utah to make a decision. Do you take a chance and run the option? Maybe put it on the ground, or do you throw the RPOs, the quick passes to the outside? Let's see what they decide to do.
I'm going to use up every second on that play clock. They run the option, but they hand it off. They'll be about 4 yards shy of a first down.
Same play to the other side.
They used their first timeout. I would have honestly taken the first timeout after first down. I think you got to take a shot and conserve as much time as you possibly can. You either stop them here or you don't.
Yeah, well, this is going to be it. You know, they will win the game if they make a first down here. Be interesting to see. Number one, are they going to take the ball out of Huntley's hands? Probably throw the ball to RPO, but do you want to throw it and stop the clock? And does BYU blitz? I think you bring heat.
I was surprised that Huntley, like you, did not keep it the first two times.
Right.
They were straight handoffs, and those looked like called handoffs, too.
Could be quarterback draw here.
Throws it out in the flat, and they won't get it.
Got to call a timeout.
How about that?
Now, if you're Utah, do you go for it?
Well, you would. Even the riverboat gambler wouldn't, would you?
Well, let's see where they spot the ball. No, it's a good long yard. I thought it was closer to half a yard.
I get the feeling now you would have gone.
Yeah, I'd come pretty close. Again, you're talking no conference game, rival game.
Right.
Go to win the game. Don't protect the lead. Go to win the game. I saw a couple of games on TV today that were rival games. And they protected the lead and they lost.
That's an excellent point.
But I would, you know, Utah's played pretty good defense tonight. With only four returning starters, they've gotten a lot better on defense. We'll see what happens.
Now, would you consider coming after the punter? This is the best kicker in the nation.
No, I wouldn't do that. I would defend that. Make sure they punt. Feel the ball. Don't let the ball hit the ground. Get as much as return as you possibly can. Don't back up past the 10-yard line.
Aleva Hefo is back. Signals fair catch. Backs all the way up to the 7-yard line. 48-yard kick and no return.
Big fourth down stop out of BYU to get the ball game turned back around to go down the score. And here's the touchdown. Good job by Tanner Mayne.
You really have to give them credit, Tommy. Against all odds, with all the mistakes they've made and the lack of offense, here they are still with a chance to go 91 yards and win this game.
Well, Utah's been their own worst enemy, but BYU has cut out the mistakes, not made too many mistakes the second half, and they've let Utah kind of choke themselves out. Now let's see what BYU's got with minute 34.
See if Ty Detmer can dig deep into his bag of tricks. They can stop the clock just once with a timeout. Mangum on the run, and he tried to run before he caught it. Aleva Hefo right in his hands.
Well, you can't coach that. It was a good play call. Tanner Mangum did a good job of getting out of the pocket and making a throw off his back foot. Hit him right in the hands. Nobody within 10 yards.
You could see his head turn. He wanted to see where the defense was. Wanted to know where to run. Just forgot to keep his eyes focused on the ball long enough. Blitz coming. Mangum throws to his tight end, Bushman. Six catches for Bushman. Clock running. Third and four. Obviously, they have to go for it if they don't make it on third. Mangum throws to the outside. Complete to Bo Tanner. Now they say incomplete. That's two passes that should have been caught that weren't.
This is
holy
a situation here. Obviously, you got to go for fourth down.
You're the quarterback. You're losing your mind because you're standing back there getting pummeled to throw the ball, and nobody can catch it for you. Do or die here, fourth and four.
Tight end.
It's his favorite receiver.
And he tried to throw it to him and he didn't get it.
Yep. And Mangum is still on the ground. That young man showed a lot of courage in the second half trying to bring his ball club back.
He took a lot of hits. He had a lot of pressure all night. Too many drop balls, but just not enough running game. Here you can see he wanted to throw the tight end off the bat. There's a man coverage, and he eventually just threw it down the field. He's going to get sacked.
BYU can stop it one more time, and that's it.
Both teams play with a lot of heart, a lot of mistakes on both sides, a lot of improvement.
They're looking at Mangum's ankle. And these are the hardest games in the world to lose. You want to beat your arch rival. You can lose the rest of them and still say, well, at least we beat such and such. And hopefully Mangum's going to be all right.
Utah's got a chance to have a real good football team. Just work out the wrinkles.
That's the last timeout with 42 seconds left. See what Utah has to face. Stanford, a team that lost today to USC, then the Trojans at Oregon. And the middle of that schedule is tough. They were the only team in the Pac-12 South that beat USC last year, however.
Utah's going to win 7 to 8 games, possibly 9. Just depends on if they stay injury-free. They've got 2 quarterbacks that can run this offense. Their receivers, they've got tons of those. BYU has got to get back to the drawing board with their offense to create some kind of running game. Tanner Mangum's not going to make it through the year having to throw the ball like he threw it tonight.
No, you're right. Kyle Whittingham says, okay, they can't stop us now. And Utah comes in here and wins a critical game for them. And these guys who have so much respect for each other come together and shake hands and hug. Utah, it's going to be an easier trip going home for them, isn't it?
Yeah, a lot easier going home. It's not that far down the road. It's not a long plane ride, but both teams have got a lot of work to do. Got a lot of work to do, but you saw improvement in BYU in a lot of areas tonight. Their defense was solid in most to a degree. But again, both teams have to cut the mistakes out. Utah's got to cut the penalties out.
For sure. Let's go to Paul.
A lot of hugs down here, Mike. A lot of connections, relationships, obviously, with Coach Whittingham, who went to BYU. Knows a ton of these coaches. Coach, defensively, before your unit took the field that last time, what was the message?
Well, get a stop, and it's essentially the ball game. And so, great job by our defense rising up. You know, I succumbed to a little bit of outside influence. Should have probably kicked the field goal there to go up 3 scores. Thought we could make the first. That falls on me. Didn't get it. And fortunately, our defense had enough in the tank to get the win. But that's a good football team over there. They play hard, and they're well coached.
On the other side of the ball, your sophomore quarterback, Tyler Huntley, had almost 400 yards of total offense. What makes that kid tick?
He's a playmaker. He's got a ton of confidence. He's got the field general mentality you look for in a quarterback. He's athletic, and he's going to get nothing but better. You watch.
You know, Coach, it's always next team up mentality with you and your staff, but this is a big game when you play BYU. Obviously, it's a huge rivalry. When the dust settles and now you've won, what does it mean to you and your program?
Well, it's, you know, in-state supremacy has some effect on some recruiting, and I'm just proud of our guys. I'm proud of our coaches and our players. Did a great job. It's on to the next one now. We got San Jose next week coming in. This is an emotionally draining game. We got to be wary of not having a hangover after this game. Be ready for the San Jose group.
Thank you, Coach.
Okay, thank you.
Coach is always thinking ahead, Tommy, and he's right. You got to worry about after your rivalry game, you have to worry about a letdown the next week.
Sure you do, especially after a rival game. But look at their defense. They pressured BYU from the beginning of the game to the end with boundary fires, corners coming, safeties coming. But they did a good job with a 4-man rush. But the coverage, you got to remember now, Chase Hanselman is the only defensive back out of the 4. They had 3 first-year starters.
And Mangum, bless his heart, is a stationary target when they come after him.
He's going to be sore tomorrow, but he will. Key to the game.
This kid was the star right here.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, he's going to be the star of a lot of games. And, again, you can tell he's agile. He can do anything off his back foot, front foot. He can make plays with his arms, with his legs. I mean, once he really learns this offense, and they got to get the center exchange down too. You know, they had that problem tonight. But he is a playmaker. Again, the spread offense is about taking a quarterback where the other defense has to defend him. And when there's a bad play, he can make a big play. And that's what you see out of all these spread quarterbacks, if they're any good.
The speed and skill that they showed tonight is going to take them a long way this season. They went here at Brigham Young 19-13. Coming up next, college football final. For Tommy Tuberville and Paul Carcaterra, this is Mike Patrick. for our entire crew, saying so long from Provo, Utah.